This is 10
preventing mental health decline, because traditionally, and I think quite we're quite accustomed with treating mental health, which is basically treating mental illness or the decline of mental health. What we are not good at, and we haven't really innovated and looked at, is really how do we prevent mental health decline in the first place? You know, and for us, one of the things that we looked at very early on was just a simple analogy between physical health and mental health. You know, and if you look at physical health, track it back, you know, 50, 60 years ago, we didn't have physical fitness. Running was a hippie sport, if at all, you know, and way before the Jane Fonda era and the, you know, Arnie in the gym, there was no mainstream physical fitness at all. We didn't have that. But what we recognized, I think, as a culture was that we were facing major human crises in health. And that was around, you know, heart attack, obesity and poor physical health. And I think we recognized that you couldn't people that problem. You couldn't staff the hospitals enough. You couldn't put enough St. John's ambulances at the bottom of the hill, if you like. And we decided, well, we need to educate people. We need to bring physical education into curricula so that we can bring literacy into physical health and then create an attractive outcome area called fitness so that people want to practice that literacy and look after and maintain their own physical health. And that's physical fitness. And then, you know, we looked down at mental health and we thought, where's the education? Where's the fitness? It's just totally absent. And that was really, that was the sort of the kernel of FICA and why Gareth and I started it. We're now a team of over 20 scientists and technologists, and we've created a data science-driven platform that delivers a formal training program of mental fitness. And fundamentally, we're trying to change culture. We're trying to celebrate the other side of mental health, and we're trying to encourage all of the people in the organizations that we work with. So we work with over 100 organizations in the UK. That's across education, healthcare, and corporate. And we encourage people to take formal training in mental fitness really seriously, because it's a duty of care, we believe, much like the education that has been missed for everyone, is a duty of care for every organization to bring some basic training in to help people maintain their mental fitness levels.
And this is really helpful to understand. And I fully get your point about mental fitness and the correlation between mental fitness and physical fitness and where the emphasis has been over the years. So I want to ask you about, because you've mentioned that you've got scientists and technologists. So how do you know that what you've put in place is evidence-based and grounded and is going to work?
Well, it's something that we decided to invest in very early on, was making sure that we were evidence-based from the start. So we have a science team that's run by Dr. Fran, who's our head of psychology, Dr. Zoe, who's our head of data and research, and Dr. Amanda, who's our head of behavioral psychology. And what we undertook in 2019, we undertook a randomized controlled trial where we looked at individuals coming into an organization, so a transition period. Because we're really interested in transition periods, because we recognized from secondary data and research papers that we looked at that during a transition period, our mental health goes into a decline. And that's, you know, that's pretty common in education. But it's common in the workplace as well. You know, joining a new business or becoming a line manager, you go into a similar decline as you do when you join you go from sixth form into college or into university. And so we prepared a randomized controlled trial, and it was run independently from us. And it looked at individuals joining an organization. And what we found was the control group declined in key measures. So the measures that we were tracking were self-efficacy, positive emotion, life satisfaction, and negative effect. And we found that in the control group, all of those measures declined over a 6-week period. And in the FICA group, we gave them the FICA programs to use, so 5-minute exercises, because our programs are created out of 5-minute micro learning exercises. And we saw an incline in all of those measures across the FICA group. So for us, that was a sort of a landmark scientific discovery for us, because not only did we prevent the decline of mental health, but we increased performance. And we like to talk about that as day one duty of care. So instead of waiting for week 6, for the decline to have happened and, you know, help to be asked for or not, as the case may be, get ahead of that and put a formal course into your induction program, so that everyone is expected to do an induction in mental fitness. And in doing that, you know, prevent some of those lines of decline and increase And performance. And we've kept doing research ever since.
Okay. So let me ask you about who you're working with, because at Zen, we work with predominantly schools. We work with some school-based teacher training providers. One of the things I'm aware of when I look at my social feed is just how many teachers in particular are reporting really quite publicly. Actually, I'm feeling really stressed. Been doing this for 6 years and I've thrown the towel in today. I can't do it anymore. I mean, this is every day I'm seeing this. So who are you working with, and how can FICA Mental Fitness help some of those groups like schools and teachers who are in their training year? And I'm thinking about students who are over 16. What can you offer and how do people work with you?
So our platform runs with a B2B license. So organisations purchase a license and then it's available for all of their population. So it's available either for their staff or for their learner populations. We started in the higher education sector. So we work with a number of universities across the UK. Then through a partnership with NCFE, we have moved into the further education sector, work with around 90 education institutions, and that's across staff and learner and student bodies. Then we've also started working with the NHS recently, so supporting nurses and staff in the NHS. And we also work with corporates, and that's just employees in the workplace. So we've done an awful lot of work with employees in education settings, and we've expanded that out to offer our services to corporates and their employees. And I think, you know, talking to the point that you started with, that along with this great resignation that we're seeing, which I think is partly potentially due to, you know, our collective contemplation during lockdown, and everyone's had a lot of time to think about where they're putting their value and their time. You know, we've seen a lot of resignations from, you know, some of the big consultancies, where I think people have decided I want more for my life than whatever work I was doing. And that's in some part, that behavioral change comes from having time to contemplate and decide to do something different. So being sort of taken out of your busy cycle. But I think what we've also seen is that people are recognizing that they're really stressed. Work is really stressful. You know, I think perhaps one of the positives that hopefully we're all going to come out from this, you know, pandemic era and recognize is that mental challenges are really high at work. We look at some market data. There was some data published by the BITC. It was published in a Deloitte article. And this data showed that the issues that contribute to most mental health decline at work are pressure for deadlines and workload, and basically business as usual. And what I think we're having to recognize now is that business as usual is really tough. We're faced with multiple and frequent mental challenges. And what we don't do is provide any support or training in advance of that. Now, I'll give you an analogy that we often use, which is, let's just say, Helen, that you're running an organization. Let's say you're running a major school group and you've got, you know, 1,000 teachers across the country, let's say, and you decided that in a month's time you're going to send them all on a 5K run.
Yeah.
Don't tell me you wouldn't give them some training. Don't tell me you wouldn't plan ahead and say, look, you've got a physical challenge coming up, 5K run. It's not that challenging, but it's, you know, what you would do is you'd probably let everybody know that there's going to be some training available. You would help encourage people to train. And you do that because you know that by providing the training in advance, they'll perform better, you will offset risk of injury, and everyone will have a much better chance of succeeding. And yet you think about things like coming back after the pandemic, returning to education settings, what an incredibly hard mental challenge that was for everybody. And yet we don't provide any training in advance of that. This isn't me pointing fingers at anybody. This is saying that culturally, for some reason, we've just missed it. We've just decided physical challenges, they need preparation for, we're all aware of it, we're aware of the benefits for it, and therefore we just go for it. We train and we encourage it, we make it a positive area of growth. What we need to do is we need to do the same thing for mental health. We need to recognize that we all face these challenges. And if we are the duty of care owners of an organization, be that an education institution or workplace, we need to recognize that actually it's our duty of care to provide some training to prevent that decline of mental health.
Yeah, I really like that. And I really like that idea of if you were preparing people for a 5K, the whole of your organisation. So let me ask you, while we're talking about the kind of difference between physical fitness and mental fitness, something I really wanted to ask you about is injury time. Okay, because sometimes we pick up a physical injury And I have this conversation with my physio and she goes, now, Helen, I have overpaces and underpaces. Which one are you? Because actually at the moment we're not training, we're in remedial recovery. You know, so we have this discussion about what I'm allowed to do and what I'm not. But I want to ask you this about our mental health as well. And I'm asking you very much, you know, located in Manchester, where we're still in the inquiry following the arena bomb, for instance, which left a lot of people with physical injuries, actually, but also a lot of people with post-traumatic stress, you know, workers, as well as people that attended the concert. So, you know, we understand very acutely that sometimes we experience injury to our mental health, and sometimes on a collective level, actually. So is FECA still relevant and helpful then, or are there some things that are counterindicated whilst you're in recovery?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question, and it, you know, it surrounds a really challenging area for our culture, which is, I guess, you know, bringing people back to health,
yeah,
or good health, shall we say, when their health has really suffered. That's not an area that we focus on at FECA.
Okay.
So, you know, typically we like to think of what we do as a prevention service. So very, very much, I mean, and again, let's just take the physical fitness analogy or the physical health analogy. We see ourselves much more like a gym.
Okay.
You would go to FECA ahead of events or just part of your everyday life, training for life, we call it. And you would build up your mental muscles, essentially, because the seven skills of mental fitness that we train people in, we like to think about them as mental muscles in some way. So like your confidence, your focus, your positivity and your motivation. We sometimes use the analogy that they're mental muscles. And through 5-minute brief exercises, you can basically exercise those muscles and gain more mental fitness, which in a way tops up your mental health. That means that when you do hit a psychological downturn, let's say you hit a difficult time, you've not only built that positivity into your approach, but you've got skills that you can reuse, and you recognize that by doing those techniques, you can increase your overall sense of management of your mental health.
Got it. And that's really helpful. So I can think, actually, I can go to the gym, but if I'm injured, I need to go and get some physio so that I understand what I need to do to get right again.
Exactly.
So we can't depend on FECA to do everything. FECA is, as you say, like a mental fitness gym. But actually, when we have some trauma or some kind of injury, we still need to get the additional professional support to help us through that time. But we go into it probably from a better place, from what the research is showing you.
Yeah, you've put it really well, Helen. And one of the things that we sometimes talk about internally, because we've got a lot of interest in mental fitness literature. That bias that we see in our culture, which is a negativity bias. If you talk about mental health to people, generally people think that's a negative. When you talk about physical health, generally people think that's a positive. So there is a real negativity bias, and we see that in research as well. We've seen many papers which talk about this is a paper on or a study on mental health, and when you read through it, it's talking about, you know, high levels of depression, anxiety. It's a study on mental illness, not mental health.
Absolutely. Now I'm hearing you. So let me ask you one final question, because this podcast will go out to hundreds, thousands of head teachers, school leaders. Have you got one message that you'd like to give school leaders?
Well, I'm going to break it into two parts. The first one is just to say thank you to the school leaders who have been through an incredibly challenging time and continued with their incredibly rewarding careers, which are to further the education of our nation. So firstly, a massive, you know, heartfelt thanks to them, I think, on behalf of, I'm a parent, I have a young daughter, and two much older children who've already been through the education system. So thank you as a parent, and I think on behalf of the country. And then I think the other message that I think I would like to put out to head teachers across the country is really to think about preventing the decline of mental health and thinking about the duty of care that we all have in the area, to think about mental education as an important part of the curriculum. Because I think it's time that we do start thinking about these skills as being as important as maths and English.
Thank you so much. That's a great message. And it's been brilliant to talk with you today. So thank you so much, Nick, for joining us on 10 with Zen.
Absolute pleasure, Helen. Thank you very much. I've enjoyed the conversation very much.
10 with Zen is brought to you by Zen Educate. Zen Educate's online platform puts you in control of supply and recruitment, and they've saved UK schools over £3 million by allowing them to connect with teachers and TAs directly. To receive 50% off your first day booked with Zen, just DM us on Twitter @ZenEducate for quote 10 with Zen. Thanks for listening.